So, so that's why I just call mitochondrial agents. So let's move on to the next one. We've talked a little bit about it before in the terms of the CEPO trial, the carbamylated EPO trial. These are EPO mimetics. Carbamylated EPO is not the only one of the kind. There are other companies exploring different mimetics of EPO, and they are all, like CEPO, aimed at giving us more frataxin protein, but without raising red blood cell counts. So we're working with several companies in that regard. TAT frataxin is a program that a lot of Europeans have been interested in and helped us support. This is the program of Dr. Mark Payne at Indiana University. It's his discovery to synthesize frataxin protein that's in short supply in our patients and deliver it to the mitochondria where the frataxin protein does its work with this protein fragment called a peptide, in this case a TAT peptide. It is recognized by our cells as belonging in the mitochondria. So it's sort of like the bus driver or the train driver that has a synthetic frataxin protein on board. It takes it right to the mitochondria, leaves it there to perform its function. It's being tested by Dr. Payne in our mouse models to very promising preliminary results. And we will be meeting with a prospective pharmaceutical partner for Dr. Payne later this month in Philadelphia, hopeful that a drug company will take up his project and do help him do the preclinical work so we can get that project into a clinical trial. Mm-hmm.
So this TAT frataxin, is it still a long way, I mean, to be tested in patients, or you think it's
If we can get him a good pharmaceutical partner that's able to do the preclinical work, and a big part of that is being able to manufacture it. Right now, Mark Payne can make it in his lab and add it to the TAT peptide, and it gets to the mitochondria of the mice, and it greatly increases their life expectancy. It practically doubles their life span and their performance. What we need is a drug company who can make the synthetic protein and the TAT molecule and combine them into a single compound and still have them work in the mouse. And that's not trivial. It's fairly difficult,
yeah.
But we're hopeful of finding the right drug company that can do it. And if they can do it, then the time between that moment and going into patients is not very long. It's getting that manufacturing process down, and then we have to try it in healthy animals, go through the preclinical. Mm-hmm. The preclinical work is almost always a year. We've tried to cut that back to 6 months, but it's very difficult to do all the safety studies in healthy animals to make sure, you know, it's ready to go into humans. So it's a two-step process with the TAT frataxin. We need to find a drug partner who can make the drug and then help us run it through the preclinical.
Oh, okay.
We have to stop for the fourth part.
Okay.
This point. Sorry. Okay. Now. Okay. Now.
First, I'd like to just go on to the next set of brand new discoveries, and there are several. One is by Dr. Rob Wilson, the founding scientific director of the Friedreich's Ataxia Research Alliance. He's at the University of Pennsylvania, and he was our first success story in terms of getting an FA assay, we called, into what we call ultra-high throughput screening, funded by the National Institutes of Health in the United States. This is a system in which there are roughly 350,000 different compounds that are approved for one thing or another, and put them on an assay of a specific disease and see which of those 350,000 compounds might be promising. Rob Wilson was our first scientist that was successful in developing an assay, a cell assay of mitochondrial function in FA. So he used yeast, and he these yeast have the same mutation in the FA gene, and he designed it such that this assay could be placed in these thousands of well plates, glass well plates, onto which robots place these 350,000 compounds multiple times in each test, and you see which of the 350,000 compounds light up the assay. There's luminescence proteins added so that, in this case, if mitochondrial function is improved by this compound, it glows. So you can see which of the 350,000 compounds might help us.
In real time, it glows in real time.
In very close. Yes, in real time.
In real time.
I mean, you see it right away, and it persists. So then, in this case, he got, let's say, a dozen glows, a dozen hits. And then he was given a grant, first by FARA and then by the NIH, to exploit those dozen hits. He narrowed it down to the single most promising compound, and now has a patent on that compound. He is very excited about this compound. It seems to be multiple function compound.
So this compound is something already in the market?
No, it's, well, it. Maybe. That's a good question. He's gotten the patent for using this compound in Friedreich's ataxia. I'll put it that way. And so yes, it will be. It could be readily available, but he's got to get it tested in FA. We are meeting with a drug company that's very much interested in working with him. We'll meet with them later this month in Philadelphia with Rob and spend several hours. They've already signed a confidentiality agreement, and we'll see if we can find him this development partner, pharmaceutical development partner. There are some other mimetics, in this case of superoxide dismutase, a project that some of our FA investigators have been working on for some time. It's the product, in this case, in one case, of a company that used to be called Eukaryon. They have a number of compounds. They're now working with a drug company in California called BioMarin, and one of our investigators is testing those formerly Eukaryon molecules in the FA mice, and the company has selected two ataxias that they think these molecules are most promising in, Friedreich's ataxia and ataxia telangiectasia. Both foundations are exploring the possibility of using such mimetics. Finally, in these newer candidates is resveratrol. Resveratrol, as many people know, is the reason we drink red wine. It's not the only reason we drink red wine, maybe, but it does come from red grapes, and it seems to be a beneficial mitochondrial agent. And Dr. Martin Delaticchi, we've just given a grant in Australia to explore even a clinical trial in FA using resveratrol. So we're excited about that prospect.